So to my right, there is Bhante Sujato, Buddhist teacher and abbot of Santi Forest Monastery of the Theravada tradition. Bhante is a scholar of early Buddhism and has authored a number of books that correlate both contemporary and historical analysis of Buddhist thought. Some of these titles are A History of Mindfulness, A Swift Pair of Messengers, and the most recent publication, White Bones, Red Rot, and Black Snakes. And to my left is Stephen Batchelor, who is known for the significant role he's played in the development of secular Buddhism, as propounded in his books Buddhism Without Beliefs and Confessions of a Buddhist Atheist. Stephen had ordained at the age of 21 and practiced under a number of respected teachers in various countries before he disappeared at 32. Stephen and his wife now travel worldwide several months each year to lead meditation retreats and teach Buddhism. He resides in France with his cat and his wife. So enough from me, I'll now hand the floor to Stephen.
A great honour to be here. It's a great privilege to meet Bhante Sujato. Having heard of his work and having followed his blog and recently having been reading his more recent book, I'm going to just sketch what I mean by secular Buddhism. I'm sometimes asked, in fact, Tina asked me this this evening, is there any room for chanting in secular Buddhism? And that suggests somehow that secular Buddhism is already up and running as some kind of institution, perhaps, that it might be possible to somehow join that church. It might already have a particular set of defining doctrines and dogmas. But that would be a mistake. I have found the term secular Buddhism a useful way to reflect upon the ways in which the Dharma is interfacing with modernity. And in terms of the opposition that Tina already mentioned, is it just another way in which the Buddhism finds its way in one world, or is it a groundbreaking rethinking of the primary ideas and values of the Dharma? I don't see why it can't be both. In the course of my own thinking and writing, I toyed with a number of contemporary ideas, agnosticism, atheism, humanism, secularism, and I'm not particularly attached to any one of them. I feel that each reflects, as it were, a different facet of our contemporary, lay, broadly secular experience that stands perhaps in opposition to what we loosely call religious. But I also don't really have any difficulty with the word religious either. I feel that we are involved in a discussion, a dialogue, not just the one that's happening this evening, but a dialogue between the cultures of Buddhist Asia as they are finding themselves in relation to the culture of modernity, the West, if you wish, although that term too, I think, is becoming increasingly redundant. But let me just say how I'm thinking in terms of what this word secular means. I do acknowledge that secular is the term of choice which we often oppose the word religious. And religious, perhaps in the more traditional sense of holding certain articles of faith and belief, religious in the sense of providing communities and cultures with rites of passage, with rituals, with communal activities, with a groundedness in their own traditional culture, of maybe a particular ethnic identity, and so forth and so on. But I also think of secular as rooted in the Latin concept seculum, which means this age or this time, this world. And I'm also aware of how secular denotes a process of what we call secularization, which has been going on really for a couple of hundred years now, where functions that previously were for the domain of the church or the temple are now being appropriated by the secular world, like education, for example. And we're moving into a period where increasingly traditional religious forms, be they Christian or Buddhist or Muslim, are either falling into disuse or becoming marginalized, or in some cases being revived and restored and becoming a basis for what we loosely call fundamentalism. But for me, my term of choice would be secular. I think it perhaps is the scene that I'm trying to mine in this encounter with modernity that seems to offer maybe the richer possibilities. And let me just say what I mean by this. I do feel that a secular approach can be more than just the adaptation or the reformation of particular traditional Asian Buddhist forms. A lot of the modernist forms of Buddhism, let's say for example Vipassana meditation, is in many ways an adaptation or a modification of certain elements within traditional Theravada Buddhism. Another example would be certain movements within the Tibetan world, like the Shambhala movement, which again is basically a modification and an update of a school of Tibetan Buddhism. Sopa Gakkai, again, is a modernist reworking of the teachings of Nichiren Daishonin. Now, despite their differences, these schools would by and large agree on the underpinning metaphysic that informs what they would regard as their goals and their aims and their deepest moral values. And those, and that worldview, that metaphysic, would be the worldview of classical India, which again is shared, it's not an exclusively Buddhist worldview, it's one that you'll find shared in Jainism, in Brahmanism, Hinduism, and so on. In other words, a soteriology, which means a way of thinking about salvation or liberation, that acknowledges that the human person is undergoing, or has undergone, or will continue to undergo a process called rebirth or reincarnation. And the goal of the spiritual path, the religious path, is to achieve liberation, salvation, by breaking the cycle of birth and death and achieving what is called nirvana by Buddhists, or union with Brahman by the Hindus. And that is what we might call the Weltanschauung, the worldview of classical Indian culture that underpins pretty much every form of traditional Buddhism we know today. Now, a secular Buddhism would be one, in my understanding, that questions that very the very necessity of adhering to that worldview. In other words, we might be able to work towards, I don't have any, I would not be so arrogant to say that we've worked out an alternative, but by letting go of that Indian worldview, that frees us, I feel, to rethink fundamental values within the Buddhist tradition. Now, I do find inspiration and perhaps justification for such a view within some of the early canonical texts of the Pali Canon. I feel that in many ways the Buddha was rebelling against the worldview of the Brahmins, that he was introducing another way of living in this world. Buddhism, of course, as it evolved, I feel in many respects, returned to a more traditional Indian worldview. But I do think we can find sufficient resources in the roots of Buddhist tradition to serve as an underpinning for a post-metaphysical secular Dhamma that is addressing the urgent concerns of our world today, and the world, of course, of future generations, who, in some respect, will continue to thrive and to flourish within the broad context of modernity, a scientific understanding of the world, a literary, philosophical culture that is underway now, in some ways, in a globalized set. So that would be my opening remark.
And thank you very much, Stephen. That's a very clear statement of position there. And I think it's of course very useful to be able to look at what are the underlying assumptions that inform these things, which often we don't make conscious. And these things, I find, very often within religious tradition are assumed by the practitioners without really reflecting on what are the assumptions, why do we believe this, what role does that play? And you know, I certainly would agree, you know, many of the things that you're talking about, that there is this need for Buddhism or Buddhist culture to engage in a meaningful way with what's happening around, in the way that the Buddha himself did, because the Buddha did not sit in an ivory castle and say, I have the truth, and I'm not going to listen to what you say because it might differ from my view, which is in fact what you do find in a lot of Buddhist circles today. The Buddha was constantly, almost the entire Digha Nikaya, much of the Majjhima Nikaya is actually records of interfaith conversations and philosophical dialogues. So the Buddha was constantly doing this and constantly, if you like, testing or articulating his own perspective within, partly within the views that he inherited from the culture around, but also by changing those views and challenging them. So this is one, I think it's important to understand that, but one problem, I guess, when I'm with your, you know, reading your books, just where patients who are Buddhist atheists, and one issue that I have is that I think that I find for myself, and you know, I want to hear what you have to say about this, but I find for myself a lack of clarity in terms of appreciating what and why it is that the Buddha questioned some things, right? And we know that he was very far from being uncritical. He was obviously extremely intelligent and obviously did not blindly and subserviently adopt beliefs around him and placed in a view where there was a great diversity of viewpoints. We know that many of the Shramana religions at the time of the Buddha overtly rejected rebirth, for example. So it's not as if the Buddha would have been, you know, an outcast in his society any more than he was already by rejecting rebirth. So if I want to say that the Buddha adopted views because they were views held in his culture, then I would look very closely at that and see specific and detailed reasons. One of the contexts that I've investigated this in, of course, is in the topic of bhikkhuni ordination, the role of women. And of course, this is another area where many people say that the Buddha adopted views from the culture around him. Now, in that particular context, you have a passage in the bhikkhuni Vinaya where it talks about the rule saying that nuns have to bow down to monks. And the Buddha actually says, you know, even in other badly taught religions, they don't allow for men to bow to women, which always seems a bit strange to me. If the other religions are badly taught, then why should we be following their teachings? But anyway, so he's specifically invoking that cultural, I mean, he's acknowledging it, whether it was him or not, but anyway, the text as it stands acknowledges that was the case. Whereas in the case of, say, the question of rebirth and some other issues, the text actually quite explicitly and very frequently say the exact opposite. This is something I have realized and seen for myself with my direct knowledge. I do not teach this having heard it from another Shramana or Brahmana. This is the Anupupa. The not heard before, yeah, and I'm a good day, so there's the Dhammacakkappavattana Sutta, these truths not heard before from another. And so, given that he was so clear in his acknowledgement of influences and also in his attestation for what he had realized with his own knowledge. If I was going to be persuaded by your position, I would need something a little bit more, meat on the bones. Thing in a purely vegetarian sense.
Okay, well, I will try to provide the tofu to argue. You acknowledge yourself. You acknowledge yourself that we are dealing with a body of literature that clearly can't uncritically be seen as simply a verbatim discourse. But this one's okay. If you hold it here, it works. That is clearly just a verbatim transcript of what the Buddha taught. And the scholarship, I think, shows very clearly that the Nikayas are a body of texts that evolved over a period of time before the canon was considered to be closed. Now, I'm aware of your objection. It's one that is often raised to my point of view, and I do regard that as a strong argument. The way I would respond, first is to look at the Buddha's whole take on the value of metaphysics, and particularly in the questions he refused to ask, the undeclared questions. Now, usually the last four are, is the Tathagata born or continues after death, does not continue after death, or both or neither. Now, that has always struck me as odd, particularly the use of the word Tathagata, which is usually understood as referring to the Buddha. We have, for example, in the Dhamma Chakravarti Sutra, and many, many instances elsewhere, where the Buddha says very clearly, this is the last birth. So why, therefore, in another context, does it say, this is something I'm not going to declare about? Elsewhere he has, very explicitly. That, to me, raised is my antennae of suspicion. And I would argue, and I think it's in a footnote in the recent book, the Tathagata here is simply the Buddha's way of referring to himself, and it means something like one. And I feel there are other passages, for example, the famous metaphor of the elephant, the blind man and the elephant, which starts by saying there were Brahmins and Shravanas in Sarvati, and they were discussing whether the world is finite, whether the world is eternal, whether the mind and the body is same or different, and whether the Tathagata exists after death or not. Now that seems a very odd question for non-Buddhists to be debating. It seems, and in fact the Pali commentary to that passage says in this instance, Tathagata means atta. It just means oneself. And it seems that those unanswered questions are really issues, the big questions that religions tend to get concerned about. So I would take that to mean that the question of what happens after death is actually not relevant to the practice of the Dhamma itself, and that practice is one that, in a way, suspends a concern with finding answers to those questions. That would be one answer I would have. There is one passage in the Kalpa Sutra at the very end where the Buddha says whether there is a Lord Kama, whether there is life after death or not, the practice of the Dhamma is still nonetheless what would be of greatest value. But I think we also have to consider that the whole issue of rebirth is one that in our current understanding of the human organism, of evolution, the whole problem of a kind of body-mind dualism that seems to be implicit in any doctrine of rebirth is very difficult to make much sense out of. And also, I feel that, again, if you look at the unanswered questions, one of them is the mind-body, I think he says the sunny eye, Jiva. Are they the same or different? Now, any Buddhist in school that affirms and has developed the doctrine of rebirth has had to adopt some kind of body-mind dualism in order to deal with rebirth. So on those grounds alone, I find that the issue of rebirth to me is actually not something that is central or, let's say, necessary for a committed and fully realized practice of the Dhamma. I also have no difficulty in the Buddha believing that that was in fact the case, that rebirth had happened. Perhaps he had experiences that supported that insight. But anyway, I'll pass it over.
Thanks. And that last point is an interesting one. What I often find, I'll come back to your point you made earlier, but I often find that the argument sort of tends to drift. I mean, this might be just a function of blogs or something like that, but it drifts from a point of saying, well, you can practice aspects of Buddhism without believing in rebirth, which I think is obviously unproblematic, to the Buddha didn't believe in rebirth, and and that was just a Hindu idea which was introduced later by Buddha Gosa, who was a Brahmin, or these kinds of quite crude interpretations. So it does tend to drift in that way. But just to come back to your earlier point, so the first point about the passage on whether the Tathagata survives death or not, I think that's, personally, I did read that in your book. I wasn't persuaded by it simply because I think there are too many unknowns in that equation to be able to draw too much of a solid conclusion from it. As you said, the word Tathagata usually means the Buddha. However, in that context, it is used in a non-Buddhist situation, so it might be one of those quite a few words which were pan-Indian terms, perhaps for an enlightened one. Perhaps, as you said, the commentary interprets it just as being oneself, which is also a curious commentarial position to take. So, I tend to be, I appreciate the point that you're making with that, and I agree that it is unusual. There's definitely a question mark over the passage, no doubt about that, but I'd be reluctant to draw any major conclusions from it because I think the interpretation is simply too uncertain. Regarding the Kalama Sutta you also mentioned, I think this is an important passage, but I don't think it's important. The idea that belief in heaven and hell is not essential for living a good life, I think that is really important, and that shows that Buddhism does not hang its morality off of its metaphysics, if you like. Yeah? So so from a Buddhist point of view, there's no need to go around in a moral panic and say, if you don't believe in heaven and hell, therefore you're going to go around and be a bad person, which apart from being a little bit insulting to people who don't believe in these things, is also not borne out by any empirical evidence. And as far as I'm aware, such empirical studies have been done tend to show the opposite, that areas with less religiosity tend to be more moral, if we take moral as being those things that religions, especially Western religions, think of as being moral, like adolescent sexuality or teen pregnancies or drug addiction or these kinds of things, all can happen to a greater degree in more heavily religious regions than in more secular regions. So I think I don't think that really has any weight in the question of whether rebirth is true or not, but it does, or whether rebirth is accepted in the suttas, but it does have weight in the sense of whether our ethical conduct is predicated on our rebirth or not. So that's just those few remarks, but I think the more important point here is you use the word metaphysics, and which is, I think, is an important term. I think it's a useful one, although, of course, it has so many different meanings. Very open to confusion, but I'm not sure, Steve, whether you're familiar with the writing of David Kalpahana.
To some extent, not all of his work. I've read two of his
books. Have you read his later books or his earlier ones?
I've read his book on causality, and I've read his work on the garden, which is obviously not known. I've not probably read the later.
Oh, okay, yeah. He developed in quite a lot of detail, especially in the later years. He used this idea of metaphysics and empiricism. And essentially, what he would mean by something metaphysical essentially would be not falsifiable.
Exactly.
That's what I thought you were using. So, And the idea, for anyone who's not familiar with it, I guess the idea originally derived from Aristotle, who talked about the physic and then talked about the metaphysic, what is beyond the physics. And the classical example is like, say, the sun and the stars hanging in the sky. So you basically have gravity that works here, because we drop stuff and it falls down, but the sun and the stars don't fall down. So they obviously work in like a different sphere. Different laws apply in the heavens than apply down here. So that's metaphysical in that sense. So it's the idea that there's realms that operate according to a completely different set of rules, if they indeed have rules at all. And of course, what's happened in the West is that that division, which is felt very strongly in the Judeo-Christian tradition, where you have this idea of God somehow standing outside of reality and reaching in, like putting his hand through the veil and manipulating stuff when he feels like it, and then sort of going back. And of course, the tendency in modern science is to eliminate that possibility. Yeah? Stars and the sun do in fact operate according to the same laws of gravity that apply down here. It's just that those laws are a bit subtle and a bit hard to figure out, but once you understand them, it actually works just the same. And God doesn't have anywhere to stand. And this is under the laws of thermodynamics in the 19th century. Yeah? Every action has an equal and opposite reaction. He can't, you know, part the Red Seas, because you've got to have a standing point to be able to do that physically. So that you can't have this thing which is supernatural, outside of nature, which can reach in and impose on nature. And it seems to me that that conception and that critique of the religious, which has been fundamental to the whole atheist critique of religion starting from the mid-19th century, is not applicable in Buddhism. And it's not applicable because there's no such thing as supernatural. Buddhism, there's no such thing as metaphysical. Everything is within nature. Things which, from the Western perspective, might be considered to be supernatural, like, say, a god, from a Buddhist perspective, are just part of nature. And that's not just an arbitrary thing. It's not a meaningless distinction. In Western theology, God is eternal. Just one example. And he asked for it. He asked for an infinite amount of time. And that infinity, I would argue, is specifically the metaphysical aspect. Because infinity is not something that can be tamed by mathematics. You can't work out, you can't infer from anything that we know here in this world to an infinity of life. Whereas, of course, from the Buddhist point of view, gods don't live forever. Gods live maybe for a very long time. Yeah? But a very long time is a lot closer to us than it is to infinity. So just as, say, in the realms of astronomy, or in the realms of quantum physics and so on, we can go a long way with empirical knowledge to kinds of knowledge and understanding which are radically different and radically unexpected from our ordinary common sense reality. It seems to me that the Buddhist way of understanding rebirth, different planes of existence, whether or not we take, I don't have to take everything about it exactly literally, okay? So I'm not arguing that everything in Buddhist cosmology is to be taken exactly literally, but the idea that consciousness can take many different forms, and that the manner in which it takes those forms are in some ways vastly different, but still comparable to what we experience here and now, to me, that's an empirical claim. It's not a metaphysical claim. As an empirical claim, it may or may not be true, but that's an entirely different matter, right? Whether it's true or not, okay? But it's testable, at least in principle. We can maybe test it through, you know, looking at past life memories or through, I don't know, tests which probably haven't been invented yet. What do you say?
I would agree with you. I think that the kind of Buddhism that I try to practice, try to understand, is one that is concerned with an understanding of the world that's entirely natural. There is no room for supernaturalism. But as soon as we take that step, as you in fact say, then any claim that is being made within the Buddhist context, let's say about rebirth, about different modalities of consciousness operating in some realm that's not accessible to us. All of this, at least in principle, is empirically, is subject to empirical testability. But that, in a sense, somehow puts the burden of proof really outside the formal exercise of Buddhist practice, unless, as some Buddhists would argue, namely my good friend Alan Wallace, for example, that Buddhist meditation is, in fact, can be used as an empirical scientific means of gaining empirical, you know, knowledge that can be falsified. I find that very difficult to understand. But I'd like to respond in a way by going back, not so much in pursuing that line of thought, but recounting my own personal struggle with the question of rebirth in particular. I was trained in the Gelugpa School of Tibetan Buddhism, which is a very much committed to rational analysis, study of text, Dharmakirti, logic, epistemology, and so forth and so on. And it's a very sophisticated and refined system. And as a young man, I studied these teachings as part of my training to become a geshe, which I failed to achieve, I have to confess. But one of the reasons I wanted to do that training was to find a way of verifying through reason the existence of rebirth, past and future lives, different realms of existence, which my Tibetan teachers assured me would be possible and arrive at some certainty through the training I was to receive. When we got to the proof, so-called, of rebirth, I found it entirely unconvincing on the terms, in fact, of the logical system that you were being taught to use. Now, this put me into a dilemma. I can actually remember waking up in the middle of the night in a cold sweat, agonizing over whether a state of consciousness must have as its substantial cause another state of consciousness, which is the primary argument used in the Tibetan tradition, and I could not, in good faith, accept that. And I really did feel that my whole pursuit of Buddhist practice was in danger of coming apart at the seams. It would certainly have been not possible for me within that particular school to continue in good faith as a representative of that tradition and not hold a conviction in the truth of rebirth. Now, what it was that in the end resolved that for me was this sudden realization that even if we knew for sure that there was no rebirth, and I'm not actually arguing that at all, I really don't know. It's something I feel that it would be arrogant for me to say it doesn't exist, because clearly I don't know that. But what I did realize was that even if it were to be shown to be false, that would not affect my core commitment to the practice of the Dharma. And that to me was a very important moment in my training. And it therefore did not lead me to reject the idea, but simply to recognize that as a practice, and I don't mean that just as meditation, I mean that as a way of life which includes both the way we understand and look at ourselves in the world, philosophically, an ethical system, a contemplative system, a complete ethical life, that rebirth is effectively irrelevant. It really made no difference to what I most deeply valued in my practice. And that, to me, that is really what my position is. I don't find these endless discussions I have had with friends and colleagues and people and critics trying to demonstrate that the Buddha did in fact understand all of his past lives or not. Frankly, I find that really beside the point. What concerns me is how I respond and live in the world of dukkha, how I react to that, how that leads me into cycles of frustration, discontent, that blocks me from engaging with the cultivation of the Eightfold Path. And I can do that as something that engages me fully as a person without requiring belief or disbelief in metaphysics. I don't know if I'm using the word metaphysics. In the doctrine of Reba. So I'd like to ask you, how does your practice is somehow enriched and maybe helped by your belief in the doctrine of rebirth? What does that give you that you would feel that you would have lost were you not able to accept that idea?
Yeah, I'm not quite sure what it is that I would have lost, because I don't know that that would be mine. But this is my own background. For myself, I was brought up as a Catholic. Around 15 or 16, I decided I couldn't believe in God anymore, because the God that they were teaching about in religion class was very much smaller than the universe that I was hearing about in physics class. And so I didn't believe, I became kind of, you know, pretty straight down the line atheist for many years. And gradually became more and more disillusioned with science and with reason. I did, you know, for example, studied philosophy of mind at UWA, and one of the things that that kind of showed me was, I think, the limits of materialist theories of consciousness. I felt then and do feel now that any attempt to sort of explain consciousness from the ground up based on brain activity is complete failure. I mean, I haven't seen anything remotely that convinces me that consciousness can be derived from brain activity. It's not even a ballpark of beginning to explain what consciousness might be. When you were talking about that argument about, from the Tibetan point of view, the argument that a mind state has to condition another mind state, I found that to be very convincing. Because in my mind, every mind state that I've ever had has been conditioned by another mind state. And I've never seen an example of a mind state that's arisen without being conditioned by another mind state. So I thought that actually was quite a convincing argument there. But anyway. But I guess maybe that's part of that difference in the background. Now, when I first encountered Buddhism, I went to Thailand, traveled around, did a bit of backpacking. The monastery was by far the cheapest place to stay at, so that was all good. I went there, did a month-long, very, very intensive Mahasi-style Vipassana retreat at the monastery called Wat Rampurna in Chiang Mai. And one of the very good things about that place and that retreat was they didn't teach you anything. They just say, you sit like this, you watch your belly go up and down, you note this and note that, and then come do 8 hours and then meditation, and then come back the next day. So you come back the next day and say, you know, oh, it was so painful, and then I cried, and then this happened, and that happened, and they say, yes, just note it and do 10 hours tomorrow. Thank you, that's very compassionate. And really, I mean, but seriously, there was no actual teaching at all. Basically, they just taught you how to meditate. So, which was fantastic for me at the time. When I came out from that, you know, I read a few Buddhist books, and one of them was by Ajahn Buddhadasa. And, of course, he certainly downplayed the idea of rebirth and seems to have been a bit ambiguous whether he rejected it completely or not. But, you know, when I read him criticizing this idea of rebirth, then I thought, oh, okay, well, that's good, you know, he believes the same thing that I do, and so that was all good. But it wasn't until I started reading the suttas, then I started realizing, actually, perhaps it wasn't as straightforward as that. But it was interesting that I remember very specifically, there's a very, very specific moment. It was on Christmas Day in 1992, on morning time in the car park of the leper colony south of Chiang Mai, when I suddenly started believing in rebirth. I was just sitting there, and it's a very nice leper colony, by the way. There's kind of parks and stuff on islands, and I was riding around. And there was a church there, and I was just sitting in the car park, and suddenly it just hit me. It's one of these things you can't, it's not a rational thing. It was just an intuitive, it was just a feeling that this world is a lot bigger than I'd ever thought it was, and that somehow I'd been here for a long, 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 long time, and that I was part of this kind of, it was just this intuitive feeling that came over me. And so I guess it was that moment that somehow those things clicked, and that teaching of rebirth made sense from that perspective. So from that time, it has been very meaningful for me. And you know, I don't think that I'd be a monk if I didn't believe in rebirth. I might be, you know, interested to go along and do some meditation on the weekend and feel a bit more stress-free than I did before, or something like that. But I really don't think that I would have the same seriousness and energy in my commitment to Buddhism if I didn't believe in rebirth. So yeah, I guess perhaps it's just at the end of the day, perhaps different personalities or something that different things will inspire a different kind of response, or different, what is it that calls us out to live a spiritual life.
I find it striking that we both, as it were, acknowledge a deeply personal moment in our engagement with the tradition that seems to have given both of us the same conclusion on a very different basis. I found that my seeing, being able to let go of rebirth, opened me up to my total commitment to Buddhist practice. For you, it was the opposite. Or maybe I should find out where this card mark is. but let's go back to the question of consciousness. You see, I think there are very few neuroscientists today who would say that consciousness is just what flickers up in the brain. There may be some. A neuroscientist called Alan Knowing published a book a couple of years ago called Out of My Head. And his understanding of consciousness was that it is meaningless to say that it is just the product of a brain producing some thought or awareness or whatever. For him, consciousness only can occur when that brain and that nervous system are interacting and embedded in an environment which includes a physical environment, our sensory world, an environment of a society, a language, and it's through the complex interactions of all of those conditions that consciousness emerges. Now this to me is not very far away from the Buddha's own recognition that consciousness arises through the meeting of an object and a sense organ, and emerges out of the interactions of the two. There's a very interesting passage that occurs twice in the canon, I'm sure you're familiar with it, once in the Sanyutta, once somewhere in the Dika, where you find 10 links of dependent origination of 12, and what is striking is that the Buddha says, when I had a breakthrough through with insight that nama rupa is the condition that gives rise to consciousness, and that consciousness is the condition that gives rise to nama rupa. Now, nama rupa, of course, is in a way just a shorthand for rupa is the environment, and nama are the fundamental sort of mental faculties of attention, intention, contact, feeling, perception, so on. Now, that model to me is one that does not take consciousness as having any kind of privileged existence within the scheme of experience, but rather is an emergent property out of a complex set of interactions. And that to me is very congruent with much of what is now going on in neuroscience and elsewhere, that has gone beyond a purely materialistic sense of consciousness as just the product of the brain, and recognizes it to emerge out of a complex of relationships. So in that regard, A, I find congruence with a very early phase of Buddhist idea, with the neuroscience, but at the same time I find it increasingly difficult, if that is the status of consciousness, to understand how in the body, dies, that there could be something still that is able to persist over into another life. I'm talking too much. One other thing. I fully appreciate the sense for the monks that a Buddhist practice, or let's say spiritual life, is one that opens up and acknowledges how infinitely vast of this world, this universe, this experience is than what I can in a way imagine with the limitations of my conceptual and linguistic capacities. And meditative experience for me is very much about opening up that sense of the sublime, as I would consider it, the sublime being that which we cannot limit to what we could represent as thought. And what you describe as, you seem to take it rather more literally as rebirth, I would see really rebirth there functioning as a symbol or a metaphor for a state of participation in a life in the world that infinitely exceeds our own capacity for representation and our own limited experience we're in now.
Yeah, thanks. I was thinking of that very passage when you were talking about that in terms of the neuroscience and the interaction. And you said that the belief in rebirth, it must be essentially dualistic. I think that Buddhist traditions have tended to become more dualistic. And I think that that's acknowledged, for example, in the Theravada tradition, that understanding of nama rupa that you were talking about is sort of fallen by the wayside, and nama rupa basically is understood as mind and body in quite a dualistic way. And that's, I think, a mistake in certainly Theravada, but I understand probably.
It's the same in my art.
Yeah. I think that the Buddhist way of looking at consciousness is, I think of it as dualistic, because to me the thing with dualism, you know, I always understand it from Genesis, you know, you've got a lump of mud and then you breathe a bit of air into it, right? And so we've got this question, how do you get the air to stick with the mud, right? Whereas from a Buddhist point of view, as exactly the passage you were referring to, you start with the complexity of experience in relationship, the inner, the eye, the forms, the contact, and the eye consciousness. That's the given. The immaterial soul and the lump of mud over here are not the given. They're already abstraction. The actual reality is a complex changing interrelationship between different aspects. And through analysis, we tease out things that we call mental as part of that, and things that we call physical, and we can analyze them. But that's secondary to the actual experience itself. But I don't. For me, that doesn't create a particular problem in terms of rebirth. I mean, I think of it by analogy, say with software and hardware. Classic kind of analogy in sort of modern thinking about consciousness. You can download your software onto a new computer, right? And well, the software stays more or less the same. It might work a bit different on the next machine, but the software has. Software is not independent. Software is nowhere completely divorced from any physical representation. It always has some physical manifestation, which might be on a hard drive, it might be on a disk, it might be in different forms, but in some way it has some physical reality, but that's not tied down to one particular physical location. So I would tend to think, you know, in terms of those kinds of metaphors, that the idea that, you know, we can distinguish between mind and body, the same way we can distinguish between software and hardware. And that, of course, was Alan Turing's insight. That's basically where modern computers come from, that insight you can run the same piece of software on different computers. That's where IT comes from.
But again, that's all very well for computers, because when our hardware crashes, then we still got our software, and then we can go pick up a piece of hardware software, and that's fine. But when we're talking about human organism, we have to explain the gap between, let's say, the decease of this body, and it's no longer being able to run the software called consciousness, if we stick with that metaphor. But then we have to explain somehow, well, how does that software and that how does it cross time and space into another hardware, which is essentially a fertilized ovum? That I find extremely difficult to understand.
And look, I'd agree with that, and I think that that's something which, at the moment, I'm just talking in terms of metaphors. So, yeah, in terms of metaphors, that needs more work, more understanding. Yeah.
But also, how do you reconcile this issue about not self and the fact that there is no self?
Yeah. I don't think that is a problem.
Oh,
what's the question?
I'm sorry.
The question is, some people are, they can't reconcile the teaching of non-self and rebirth, because what then is reborn to the next life if there is no single entity that is the same thing that carries on here?
One way of looking at that is just in terms of that same analogy of data or software, that there's no, it doesn't consist of one single thing, and it doesn't mean that it's not changing, it can change and so on, but what we say in terms of new life is that there's certain memories, certain, I guess, personality patterns, traits, and these kinds of things, which are not necessarily identical with the previous life, but which have enough in common with the previous life that you can still call them the same person, in the same way that I'm not the same as I was 10 years ago, I'm not the same person that I was before I had a cup of coffee before the talk this evening. But still recognisably the same, that if I committed a crime before that, I could still be arrested afterwards.
If one posits a continuity of, let's say, consciousness among the chief and another interesting is that Buddha never provides a mechanism to explain rebirth.
That's right.
And that to me is telling.
That to me is somehow telling. And every Buddhist tradition has had to come up, has had to introduce something that's not in the canon, whether it be the Bhagavad-gita or whether it be the Aryabhatta or whatever it is, that is able to then somehow explain. And I find that strange for someone, let's accept your point that the Buddha had, a very clear affirmation of the doctrine of rebirth. We can also see that the Buddha gives extremely precise accounts of how, say, for example, the 12 things of compassion and origination work. Why doesn't he provide us with that? I find that odd. But going back to your point here, if, let's for the sake of argument, we can imagine some consciousness or something that is able to cross the gap between a dead body and a fertilized ovum, that to me is just as much an adequate vehicle for the continuity of personal identity as Bhante says, the continuity of my physical entity, my physical body, nervous system, and brain in the course of a series of days. I don't find that problematic. I don't find that objection really problematic. The problem is, how do we explain the gap between a corpse and a fertilized ovum, and what it is, and how does something which I think has to be long physical make that transition? I find that to be incomprehensible and somewhat incoherent, and to feel that I had to base my Buddhism and I had to somehow accept that rebirth doctrine would be largely impossible for me without having first got some sort of account that would credibly account for that transition.
See, your point's well taken that there's no detailed explanation of the mechanism of rebirth in the early canon. And as you quite rightly say, the schools give you a need to develop that in more detail. I'm not quite sure whether that's how pertinent that is, because you could say the same thing about many different things, including, say, the process of meditation, where we very often don't find much details in the early canon that's filled in by tradition. So I'm not quite sure how strong you can take that. But maybe I'd like to move on to another question which we talked a little bit about beforehand, which is the question of why does it matter so much? And I find it's very interesting that two things that, three things, even two these days, is rebirth and women. Now, if I talk about these things on my blog, lots of comments, and often very, very heated ones, yeah? That people get very excited by these things. Why? It's, I think it's very, there's a huge emotional touch. When we did the first ordination, the Kuni ordination in Perth, you know, I mean, I could feel this huge emotional charge. There's clearly something that tells me that there's something in the tradition, there's something in the community, something in the way that we feel or relate to the Dhamma, which means that somehow that energy is being held somewhere or means something. And I find the same thing with rebirth. I find this is quite fascinating. There was an interesting remark made about that by, I think, our probably mutual friend Patrick Carney. Do you know Patrick?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know Patrick, but he made an interesting comment at a conference a few years ago. He said that a tradition is not a kind of a received and static body of doctrine, but a tradition is much more like a family argument. And it's not defined by all agreeing about the same things. It's defined by the fact that you care enough to disagree about them. And like a family argument, he said, you know, Christmas time, your family sits there, and what defines your family is that you argue about the same things that you argued about last Christmas. That's what makes your family. And so within Buddhism, we care about rebirth enough to argue about it. And to me, that raises a lot of, why is that? Is that because our spiritual quest has come from a response to a fear of death, and we want to try to grapple with that? And is that getting to some kind of primal motivation or primal fear? Or is it because of a sense of meaningless, where we're adrift in a world where everything's been deconstructed by science and reason, and we want perhaps a hope of something better or a fear of something worse?
I think all of those factors probably play a role. I've also been surprised in the same way as you have. When I published my book, Buddhism Without Beliefs, I suggested we could have an agnostic position to rebirth. In other words, just to honestly say, I don't know. But that unleashed, to me, a very surprising gut reaction from many elements within the Buddhist community. It also provoked a lot of relief, I think, in many Western Buddhists who felt that they had somehow had to keep that concern to themselves, that they hadn't really felt permission in a way to be able to question some of these ideas. But you're right, it is very much an issue that carries a lot of emotional charge. I would also suggest that in terms of, say, Buddhist ideology, it's not quite the right word, but if you take out the notion of rebirth from the traditional explanations of how Buddhism works, what it's about, what it's for, it's like taking out a keystone in a building, and the rest of the edifice is then, in a way, risks crashing down to earth. So I feel, and I recognize that that's true, that traditional Buddhism, if you take rebirth out, in a way, the whole edifice is threatened. So I feel it might also be a fear that somehow Buddhism itself would be, you know, fatally compromised should one remove that keystone. I don't have a fear there. In fact, frankly, I find that is a rather liberating idea. It means that we can perhaps, you know, begin to build something out of the rubble, as it were, and go back to the beginning, go back to the early canonical material, which in my own journey through Buddhism has really been the great discovery. After Tibetan Buddhism and Zen Buddhism, it's the discovery of the Dhamma canon. The students, and again, I think we're on the same page here. To me, that is the most profound resource that we have. I think it's one of the great treasures of humankind. And I think we are a long way from really tapping the potential of understanding and other forms of maybe thinking about Buddhism that are implicit within itself. So I see it as a very rich set of possibilities that are opened up.
I'm also very creatively inspired by the possibilities of chaos. Interesting that we were getting a tea from Sam down there, but it's interesting that movement to the public canon, again we discussed a little bit earlier, King Mongkut, that he also, you know, went back very much to the Pali Canon, rejected the Buddhism that was being practiced at his time. He dismissed it as being, well, he used the word Achyamakapikavada, which he adopted from the Second Council. Yeah, this is the tradition which just mindlessly follows what has been done. What is allowable is what has been done in the tradition. He rejected that. And introduced the Pali Canon, and yet, at the same time, was very skeptical. Seems that he probably didn't believe in rebirth, and he probably didn't believe it's probably possible to get enlightened. Although it's maybe a little bit heretical to say this, but apparently you've got references to Nibbana were actually removed from the ordination procedure in Thailand for a period of time. Yeah, it says, you know, I'm ordaining for the sake of realizing Nibbana. And the mainstream position had that realization of awakening was no longer possible. Had become so entrenched, it was actually removed from the ordination procedure. I think it's been put back in since. So, but I find it is fascinating that those same set of issues, you know, that we feel and we're discussing now were already discussed more than 150 years ago. But of course, Mongkut was in a very different position in that he had to uphold his religion in order to keep his nation together. That was his priority, clearly.